I both like and don't like this podium. I like that it's wide, but I also don't like that it's clear so you can still see my legs shake when I'm nervous. I want to start by telling a story. This happened when I was about 8 or 9. Me and my family decided to go feed the ducks. And me being the rambunctious kid that I was and still am, I decided it'd be a fun idea to throw the bread over here, watch the ducks swim, and then run back over here, throw the bread, and just watch the ducks swim back and forth. It's like a cat with a laser, but instead it was bread and geese. But my parents were like, hey, you need to slow down. You're going to fall in. I, of course, did not listen. So I kept running back and forth, watching the ducks swim. And my parents said again, hey, slow down. Stop. You're going to fall in. But I just kept on going. I didn't listen. And as you could probably tell where this is going, I slip, splash, right into the water, straight down to the bottom. As I'm floating up, my parents are running towards me. And they're like, are you okay? Let's get you out of there. Let's go home. Take a shower. I'm like, why do I have to take a shower? Why do I have to take a shower? And you're covered in goose poop. And since that day, that's what my parents have called me. Why do I share this story? Well, because we're going to be talking about Ephesians chapter 6, verses 1 through 9. And in this passage, Paul is telling the Ephesians about what a relationship between a child and a parent should look like. He will also tell the Ephesians what a relationship between a bondservant and their master should look like. And of course, as we learned yesterday, this follows Paul's section on husbands and wives. So what is Paul trying to get across about these relationships? We will see as we dive into this section in Ephesians that Paul is trying to show the Ephesians and us what obedience looks like in these relationships. And the reason I shared my story is because I did not obey, and see where that got me. The title of this lesson is God-pleasing obedience. I could say, obey God, listen to what the Bible says, and end the lesson there. But there is more to obedience. We want to look at what God-pleasing obedience looks like in our relationship with other people. Who else are we supposed to listen to and obey? Our teachers? Our bosses? Our parents? Are we supposed to go around to people like our teachers and our parents and go, hey, you're not God. I don't have to listen to what you say. Imagine if I pulled that excuse with Matt Gloy for not doing my homework. There's a lot more to obedience than read the Bible. And we're going to see that as we study the first part of Ephesians 6. Colton mentioned yesterday, specifically with husbands and wives, when it comes to our relationship with people, why we love and submit is because we have reverence for Christ, out of this deep respect for God. Ephesians 6 will go on and talk about the obedience and submission in other relationships. And that's what we're going to look at today. Let's go ahead and read the first four verses of Ephesians chapter 6. They read, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother. This is the first commandment with a promise, that it may go well with you, that you may live long in the land. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in discipline and instruction of the Lord. It starts off by talking about children and their relationships with their parents. What does it say about obedience? Children, obey your parents. But why? Because this is right. Not because God doesn't want children to have any fun. How many of you felt that when your parents told you to do something or not to do something, they were just being old, boring fuddy-duddies and didn't want you to have any fun at all? Hey, Don't draw on the walls. Hey, it's time to put your toys away. Hey, don't eat that. The reason we are told to obey our parents is not because we weren't allowed to have any fun, but because God says it's right. And out of reverence for Christ, we should go, okay, that's enough. You said it was right. Let's just respect that. But there's more to it. I believe there's a reason God says it's right. It's a lot more than, oh, God said so. It's for our protection and well-being. The passage will bring up the commandments to honor your father and mother, and then it will bring up why, that it may go well with you, that you may live long in the land. The reason we were to behave as children is not to be slaves or to not have fun, but because our parents were looking out for our well-being. The same way everything God told the Israelites to do or not to, to do was out of love, our parents are telling us to do things out of love for us. If our parents didn't tell us that it was wrong to draw on the walls as kids, we'd probably have some very unique murals around the Sunset Building. If our parents never told us not to eat our Legos, we probably wouldn't be here right now. God commands us to obey our parents for our protection and well-being. The reason my parents told me to stop running while feeding the ducks is because they wanted to protect me from falling in. The reason my parents told me to go take a shower is because they didn't want me to smell like geese. It was for my well-being. The passage will mention parents, specifically fathers as well. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. A lot of you are parents, a lot of you are fathers. And if you're not, remember this for the future. Your job is to teach your child this obedience. Teach them to obey the Lord. Teach them to be subject to others. Teach them that the reason you tell them to do certain things is for their well-being. It's not on the child to just know they have to obey. Someone has to teach them. And parents, that's you. So, now how does this apply? We're adults now. We've moved out of the house. As adults, who are we to be subject to? If we keep reading Ephesians 6, Paul will talk about the relationship between bondservants and their masters. Unlike the relationships with husbands and wives, or parents and children, we don't see a lot of bondservants with masters today. But if we are to take this example that was common in that culture and apply it today, it would be more like an employee and a boss relationship. But we're not all employed. But we have been commanded to humble ourselves, to lower ourselves like a servant in our relationship with anyone. I say this because I want you to know before we read this next passage that it actually applies to us. We might read this and think, it doesn't apply to me because we are not bondservants. But we are told over and over again to act like bondservants in humility. So what does this passage say about obedience of bondservants? Let's continue reading, starting back up in verse 5 of Ephesians 6. Bondservants, obey your earthly masters with fear and trembling, with a sincere heart, as you would Christ, not by the way of eye service, as people pleasers, but as bondservants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, rendering service with a good will as to the Lord and not to man, knowing that whatever good anyone does, this he will receive back from the Lord, whether he is a bondservant or is free. Masters, do the same to them, and stop your threatening, knowing that he who is both their master and yours is in heaven, and there is no partiality in him. There's an attitude we're supposed to have with obedience. The scripture says, with fear and trembling, and with a sincere heart. There's an attitude of respect that needs to come with obedience. This fear and trembling is not, ooh, I'm scared. But it's respect. It also needs to be genuine. We can't fake this respect. We need to treat our teachers, our bosses, our elders the way we would Christ, not with an attitude of, do I have to? But with this attitude of respect for God, because this is what God has asked us to do. The scripture will also say, not by the way of eye service as people pleasers. We aren't to do this as teachers' pets, or so people will see how awesome we are. That defeats the whole purpose of the sincere heart. This next section is monumental. But as bondservants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, rendering service with a good will as to the Lord and not to man. We obey our teachers and bosses and our elders with respect and sincerity, not for their sake, but for God. Let me say that again. We obey our teachers, our bosses, and our elders with respect and sincerity, not for their sake, but for God. Submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. Why do we obey? Why do we show respect to others? Because God asked us to, and we respect God. Continuing in Ephesians 6, knowing that whatever good anyone does, this he will receive back from the Lord, whether he is a bondservant or is free. God sees what we do, and he blesses us for it. God sees our sincere heart, sees our obedience, and blesses us. Maybe not in this lifetime, but in the eternal lifetime to come. Verse 9 tells the masters to do the same. Masters, do the same to them, and stop your threatening, knowing that he who is both their master and yours is in heaven, and that there is no partiality with him. In a mentoring relationship, when we play the role of the mentor, the same way the student is to show respect by obedience, we are to show respect to the student. God does not like teachers more than students, or bosses more than employees, husbands more than wives, or parents more than children. We are equal in his eyes. And he commands us all to do the same thing. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Colton told us what this looks like in the husband-wife relationship, and we've seen what it looks like in the parent-child relationship. Child, obey your parents. Parents, teach your kids the way of the Lord with love. We've seen what it looks like in a bondservant-master relationship. Bondservants sincerely obey with respect for God, the same way you would Christ. And masters, treat bondservants with respect by treating them with love and kindness instead of harshness. God-pleasing obedience is a lot more than read your Bible. It's respect. Why are children supposed to obey their parents? Respect. Why are bondservants supposed to obey their masters? Respect. And why are we to obey God? Respect. What does God-pleasing obedience look like? It looks like respect. And why do we respect others? Because we respect God. So what does God-pleasing obedience look like in today? In practical examples. What does respecting others because we respect God look like? I think it can be summed up in the two greatest commands. Love God and love your neighbor. If someone has their hands full as they're walking through the door and they ask you to hold open the door, hold it open. Amers, if Gibby asks you to write a 5-page sermon for homework, write the 5-page sermon. Okay, that example was more to get brownie points from Gibby. If Debbie asks us to set up the FLC with tables and chairs, we do it. If Tim Burrow asks us to put the chairs up after chapel, we do it. Because we have to? No. Because they told us to? Not really. But because God told us that's what God-pleasing obedience looks like. My challenge to you, as you interact with your family and friends this Thanksgiving, as we're about to go and leave and eat some amazing food, can I get an amen?
Amen.
If someone asks you to help set the table, or take out the trash, or set up chairs, or help Granny to the car, show them your love for God by obeying and serving. Why? Because that's what God-pleasing obedience looks like.